edge. But again, that edge would not be as strong as a curved edge of a burn. So if the capsule has to give way, it would give way from that point, because that would not be that two times or three times stronger point than the rest of the curved edge with the Zepto or with the capsulo laser. Sir, your question?
What should be the minimum size of incision?
For?
Zepto.
For Zepto, minimum size is 2.2 millimeters. So I showed you in my video, I was using that incision marker, and that incision size was 2.2, and the Zepto went in very comfortably from a 2.2 incision.
Okay. If capsule is fibrotic, or you can say that some calcified entire capsule is there, does it make a difference?
Theoretically, it is supposed to cut through or weaken the fibrose or a calcified capsule, but unfortunately, practically, I haven't come across such a capsule where I could show my video recordings of what actually happened. The only anterior capsule of fibrosis I could show you was a central patch, so it was not really a challenge for a Zepto. I was hoping that someday some patient will come up which will have more extensive fibrosis, and even if I have to do it free of cost, I would do that with a Zepto to see what Zepto could do in such a situation. But yes, theoretically they say it helps a lot.
In how many size that Zepto is available? I mean to say the size of CCC.
Zepto is designed at 5.25, so it opens up to about 5.25 to 5.5, which is technically a little large, because we would prefer an exact 5 mm rexis, because that would give us a good half mm overlap on all around a 6 mm IUL. Even in a femto laser, when we do with a 5 mm rexis, we find that the overlap is a little less. I don't know, that was my personal experience. So I started using 4.9 or 4.8 rexis size to get an ideal overlap of a 6 mm IUL. Dr. Basavada, what has been your experience in this?
I agree totally with you. 4.8 is my choice.
Okay.
But never more than 5.
Never more than
because
5.
Because if you see 6 millimeter, you want some decent curve. The idea is that the whole anterior capsule which lies on the IOL will plaster the lens on the posterior capsule. So it has a kind of a pressure profile. So you need some rim to be effective. Otherwise, it's not worth having it. And it will not maintain that ELP position.
So 4.8 with a femto laser. So Zepto is coming out to be 5.5, so that is not a healthy size. So we've been talking and having meetings with the Zepto people who have designed this, and we've asked them to make a smaller CCC opening so that we are more comfortable. They said they're working on it, but only you Indians have come up with this requirement of a smaller size. All others are feeling very comfortable about it. I couldn't understand why.
Sir, about long-term follow-up, as far as capsular contraction is concerned, what's about the Zepto?
So far, our series, the period which we have faced is very short. It's only about a year or something. We have not faced any situation of capsular fibrosis the way we would see in a routine needle capsulotomy with a smaller size. But maybe that is because the edge is rounded and the edge size is bigger, so chances of capsular back fibrosis and phimosis is negligible. Any other question for... I would say that still, all over the world, 90% of the rexis is done by needle. Dr. Basavada, would you agree to that figure? 99% probably. So needle is still the basis of capsulotomy. And these modalities are expensive. So in the Indian scenario, they cannot be used as a routine. They can be used in some special situations. We started using Zepto, and when we had to use them in, say, insurance patients, we have sent special requests to the insurance company that add on Zepto because of this reason. And we are normally using it for, one is white turgid cataracts, so that and very, very hard brown grade 5 cataract. So we say we need an add-on use of a Zepto handpiece. which is disposable. So if it's disposable, the insurance companies are nice enough once in a while to give us the cost of a Zepto, so that works very well. In fact, these days insurance companies have started giving Maligen ring also as an add-on. Sir, have you experienced that with the insurance companies? This is very new. Previously, they used to just fix a fixed package, but now you started saying, okay, in the fixed package, I need to use a Maligen ring, and so they give us an additional cost for the Maligen ring, and in one, two cases, they've even given us the cost of the Zepto handpiece. So that was a real new phenomena that has happened recently. Anybody? I don't know. Maybe some clerk sitting there at that level doesn't know the difference. This is all over. So with that, I thank you all for making this session successful and such a patient and a nice audience. Thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Vasavda, and thank you, Dr. Rashad. Thank you for bearing with us through if you all haven't had your lunch, and this is still the right time.
The advantages, they are commercially available. Shelf life is not an issue, and they have safe pH and are easily tolerated by the patients, non-toxic to the eye. Going back to, this was a study which was conducted way back in 1995, bacterial keratitis study. This compared basically the monotherapy with ofloxacin versus a combination with cefazolin and tobramycin, and they found that effectivity, this was a multi-center study which was done in US, and 28 centers were involved in it. And they, at the end of it, they had studied about 250 patients with corneal ulcers, bacterial corneal ulcers, and they concluded that there is not much of a difference between the outcome when you're using ofloxacin or combination of cefazolin and tobramycin. However, ofloxacin, we all know that has is not very commonly used these days because of the issue of bacterial resistance. This, however, is a recent paper, 2016, from RP Center, Dr. Namrata Sharma and group. And they did the similar study now with gatifloxacin versus tobramycin and cefazolin combination. And they also, at the end of the study, concluded that in a non-perforated ulcers, both have equal effectivity. So the question then comes, why should we not be using monotherapy, and why should we be continuing with combination therapy? So this is an ad which, it's a full page ad which came to in the Times of India newspaper yesterday. I just taken it from there. So you can see the main, what this ad is saying is, now in India, the antibiotic resistance is a major issue, and not just the poultry or the animal husbandry, this is now affecting the humans also. And this ad basically is promoting antibiotic-free chicken for the children. However, this issue is real, and you have to understand that the resistance that we are seeing in against the bacteria, it's, of course, what we use indiscriminately, the antibiotics for infections, systemically or ocular, but more than that, what is responsible for the development of resistance is the use of indiscriminate use of antibiotics in animal husbandry. So that's a serious concern about the antibiotic resistance which has come over the past few years. So if you will see this graph, you will see this is for keratitis, and this is for conjunctivitis, and this is for endophthalmitis, and the resistance to fluoroquinolone, you will see over the years, has tremendously the resistance has increased tremendously. When moxifloxacin and gatifloxacin were introduced in the market with the addition of an 8-methoxy ring, it was particularly thought that they probably would be able to combat the antibiotic resistance, which was at that time developing against the first and the second generation fluoroquinolones. However, over the period of time, we have seen that even both gatifloxacin and moxifloxacin, there is an increasing resistance which we are seeing. So this is what you can see, like, I mean, in the beginning, while the